Good evening. Welcome to our first meeting of the Budget Finance Committee, where we review the budget requests from the department heads. I'd like to welcome everyone that's here and you guys online as well. We're going to start first with Deanna Doyle. She's with the Maine Public Employee Retirement System, and she's the PLD Plan Administrator and Member Services. So I'm going to ask her to go ahead with her proposal.
So good evening, everyone. I am just going to give you a high level information about how the plan works and what benefits we offer that come along with the plan, and answer any questions that you may have. We'll talk a little bit about, since you're a budget committee, pricing and that kind of thing, and the different choices that you have to choose from for retirement plans for your employees, should you choose to do so. So the retirement system offers a defined benefit retirement plan. So this is a true pension type plan where your employees' benefits would be calculated using a specific formula that takes into consideration their years of service, their age at retirement in some situations, and their earnings while they participate with you. So their service credit, age, and earnings. So I'm going to talk to you a little bit more about what that is all about in a bit, but just know that it's a set benefit for their lifetime, and that's the type of plan that we offer. Along with that plan comes survivor benefits. So basically, if a person is a member and participating in the retirement system and they pass away before they get to retire from the system, then we will pay benefits to their survivors. We offer beneficiaries every choice of benefit available, and they get to choose what they want out of those benefits. So just know that somebody gets the benefits if the actual employee does not receive them. This plan also comes with a disability retirement program, so it's not anything extra you have to pay for, and it is a permanent disability retirement income plan, so it is not an insurance product. And if your employees become permanently unable to perform their job because of condition they develop, then they can be eligible for this benefit. It replaces 59% of their income. And they actually receive service while they receive a disability benefit and eventually change over to a service retirement benefit once the benefits equal or exceed each other. A separate program that we also administer is our group life insurance program. So that's available for the town to pick up separately from the defined benefit plan if it wishes to. And if you have questions about that, I'll go into that in a little more detail later. So we're very much a financial institution. We've been around since 1942, and we're a little over $18 billion in assets, and our monthly retirement payroll is around $10 million a month that we pay out in benefits. So we're very highly regulated. So some terms I'm going to use: the participating local district plan is the plan you're looking at joining, and right now we have over 300 active employers participating in that plan, and you're going to be sharing the costs of providing retirement plans with those other employers in the state of Maine. Okay. Vesting: to be vested in this type of plan, you have to have 5 years of service credit. And what that means is that once you have that 5 years, as long as you leave your money with us, even if you don't work right up until you retire, you're eligible for benefits once you reach your normal retirement age. Okay, so that 5 years makes you eligible at normal retirement age, which under the regular plans is 65 or 60, depending on when your employees first started participating in our plan. Right. The cost of living adjustment provision is one that I believe that you looked at for your public safety folks. And it's a provision that you can adopt or you cannot adopt. And what it does is it allows their benefits after they retire to grow with the cost of living. So once they're eligible for that adjustment, they receive it every year, as long as you adopt a plan that has that provision. Okay. The average final compensation is just the base of somebody's retirement benefit calculation. So we simply average their three highest years of earnings, and that forms the base of their benefit calculation. So your employees will participate with us, and they will pay contributions, retirement contributions on the salary and wages they're paid for services rendered, and so will the town. So you'll pay a certain percentage of their gross earnings to the retirement system, and that's the money we use to fund their benefits. Okay. Credible service: as your employees work, they're going to be granted service credit, prorated against full time. So as long as a person's full time after a full year of employment, they have a year of service. If you decide to cover your part-time employees, then they will earn service credit at a lesser rate. So for instance, if they're half-time, it will take them 10 years to earn the 5 years to be vested. Okay. While a person's a member, there are different situations where we will grant them additional service credit. So if they are on an unpaid leave of absence, the law requires us to grant them up to a month of service every year to try to keep their service whole. If they go on a military leave of absence, we can grant them up to 5 years of military leave service as long as they qualify when they return and provide us with their paperwork. And when they go to retire, if they have 20 or more years, they can be granted additional service credit in their benefit calculation for accumulated unpaid sick or vacation leave. All right. And then there's a lot of different categories of service that members can purchase with us. And if they buy that time, we'll use it when we go to calculate their retirement benefit. So types of purchasable service: if the town joins, they can allow their employees to purchase credit for time worked for the town before you joined, so that's prior service. They can purchase up to 4 years of credit for active duty military service. They can purchase credit back if they were a member of the retirement system before, and when they got done, they took their money out. They can buy that time back. They can purchase out-of-state service, so that if they worked for a public employer in another state, they can buy that time towards their main benefit, as long as they're not going to receive a benefit from the other state. And then there's a whole bunch of other different types of service. So the participating local district plan actually has 11. It's been a long day. 11 subplans that you could choose from. Three of those are what we call regular retirement plans, and those all have a normal retirement age associated with them of 65 or 60. And then there are special retirement plans, and those plans allow members to either retire at a younger age with no reduction in their benefit, or they allow them to retire with a higher level of benefits than the regular plan provides, or both. All right, so the plan that you've chosen for your fire and emergency medical services employees does both. Okay. So the regular retirement plan, which most of our employers have for their general government employees, they have a regular plan. A person qualifies to retire from that plan once they have a total of 25 years of service. They can retire even if they're younger than 65 or 60, or they can retire once they reach that normal retirement age of 65 or 60, as long as they have either worked right up until they want to retire and have accrued at least one service right before retirement, or as long as they had at least that 5 years before they stopped working and now they're just coming back and filing for their retirement benefit. All right. So to get money from this plan, it's one or the other. You could have 25 years, or you have to be normal retirement age to draw. So the regular retirement plan A is the plan that by far is the most popular of our regular plans. A with COLA is the most popular. And the COLA is the cost of living adjustment provision. So that plan provides a person with a benefit that's basically 2% of that three higher average, that average final compensation, for each year of service they have, as long as they retire at normal retirement age or older. So it's 2% per year. If they have 10 years, they get 20% of their three higher average, 25 years gives them 50%, and so on. Okay. There is no maximum benefit. I had a person retire 54 years of service, got 108% of their average in retirement for the rest of their life. I don't know how long they drew it, but they did have that. So normal retirement age up for your employees is either going to be 65 or 60, and that is determined by the first date they ever participated with any employer in our participating local district plan. So you don't have any control over that, is what I'm saying. If they first started with us before July 1st, 2014, then they have a normal retirement age of 60, and that stays with them, where no matter who they go to work for. If they first participated on or after July 1st, 2014, then their normal retirement age is 65. People who have 25 years of service can retire under the regular plan, regardless of their age, but if they retire before their normal retirement age, there's a reduction because they're gonna draw their benefit over a longer period of time. And so they do receive a little bit less in their benefit if they choose to retire younger than 65 or 60. All right, and once they retire, that cost of living adjustment is annual and ongoing. So the rates for this plan that are based, you know, you pay them on your employees that participate on their gross earnings. For the employer, the current rate is 10.2%, and it's staying 10.2% for the next fiscal year, starting July 1st. Employee contribution rates are different for normal retirement ages of 60 and 65. So we're looking at the plan that has COLA, but there, I did give you the no COLA rates as well, if you want to do that. So the COLA for this year is 7.6 if their normal retirement age is 60, and it's going to 7.7 starting July 1st. If their normal retirement age is 65, the COLA plan, it's 6.85 currently, and starting July 1st is going to 6.95%. Now in your packet, you do have a rate sheet that gives you the last 3 years of rates for all 11 plans for the employee and the employer. So you can see that we try, the committee that oversees this plan tries very hard to keep those rates consistent year to year, so that nobody has anything shocking. It's also important to know that these rates can only go so high for the employer and the employee. There are maximum contribution rates for each of the sub plans, that your rates can't go higher than. So it's helps you budgeting when you know that you're not going to go any higher than a certain amount. Now the rates do change or subject to change every July 1st, and we actually set those rates and publish them around mid-December of the year before. So we announce to you that the rates are going to be X starting July 1st, so you know ahead of time for budgeting. Any questions about that so far? Okay, I did give you also the rates for special plans 2 and 3 because you have adopted or will be looking at adopting 3C for your fire and EMS employees. So I gave you that information, and I gave you the rates for special plan 2 because it's the only special plan that you could adopt for your regular general government employees. So special plan 2 provides somebody with the ability to retire once they have the 25 years, no matter what age they are when they get there, without a reduction in their benefits. So they don't have the normal retirement age of 65 or 60. Once they have that 25 years, if they're 48, they can retire with an unreduced benefit. There aren't very many employers that have that special plan for their employees, but there are some, and there is interest in that recently for employers. So that's why I'm bringing it to you. And these next slides in your packet just show how we go about calculating somebody's benefit. So we pick out the three highest years of earnings, no matter where they are during a person's participation in the PLD plan. It doesn't have to be consecutive. It doesn't even have to be all with the same PLD employer. We're going to pick them out wherever they are in the person's employment history with us and average them together. If you know a state employee or you're married to a public school teacher, perhaps you talk retirement with them, or they're going to talk to you about the fact that they have limits on the amount of compensation they can have included in the calculation of their three higher average, and they do. But the participating local district plan is totally separate. It has its own laws and rules that apply to it, and there is no cap on compensation in the calculation. All right, so these are just examples under regular Plan A of how we go about calculating a person's benefit depending on how many years of service they have, if they're 65 or 60 when they retire, whatever their normal retirement age is. Also in your packet, you have this handout here. It says monthly benefit examples. So it basically gives you the same information, but looking at monthly benefit amounts under our full benefit option. So one column has the years of service a person can retire with. Across the top are different ranges that a person's average might fall into. And those are looking at monthly benefit amounts in those situations. So one question I already have was, you know, if only somebody's only gonna be here and work another 5-6 years, is it worth it? This can help answer that question. And what a person would do is take, well, this is what my annual salary is. I'm gonna pay this rate to get this benefit. How long is it gonna take me to recoup that money? You're gonna find it doesn't take very long, and the benefit is lifetime. All right, so that is that. This next example just shows the calculation, how we'd calculate somebody's benefit under Special Plan 2 or 3, regardless of how old they are. All right, so it's just an example of the calculation under those plans. So are folks going to be able to retire and just live off the benefit we provide them all by itself? The answer to that is no. It's the same answer to the question, can they live on their Social Security benefit all by itself? And the answer is no. All right. If they don't want to go back to work after they retire, they have to have 70 to 90% of their income still coming in retirement to maintain their standard of living. So if you do join our plan, the town of Raymond has what we call a Section 218 agreement with Social Security. And that will mean that Maine PERS will be in addition to Social Security, not instead of. And that will mean that for people that opt to participate in Maine PERS, they're gonna pay into both, and so is the town, right? So those rates will be on top of what you're already paying into Social Security for both the employee and the employer. That's pretty hefty for folks, but when they go to retire, Social Security benefits aren't reduced because they paid into Social Security the whole time, and they're also just getting a Maine PERS benefit. Where for your public school teachers and your state employees that only pay into Maine PERS, their Social Security benefits are offset or reduced. Okay, so that wouldn't be the case for your employees, but they would have to pay into both, which is hefty. So Social Security comes into play for folks as a benefit if they've qualified for it, and they should have an idea of what that is. Social Security at the maximum replaces about 42% of your income. Personal retirement savings accounts are the IRAs and Roth IRAs and 457 and 401A and 401K type of plans that are out there. Many different options for saving for retirement there. And also somebody may be able to accrue more than 25 years with us, and they will get additional benefit for every year over that 25 year mark. So Maine PERS does offer a partner or a deferred compensation or defined contribution plan for employers if they want to pick it up along with the defined benefit plan. It gives their employees a choice. You may already have one through somebody else, which is fine. But just know that that is something that's available, can be adopted later on, now, later, never. Okay. So employees who may change jobs, I mentioned there's over 300 employers, and that's also a great way to recruit people, because you can recruit people from other employers and they can stay essentially under the same retirement plan. But employment changes do matter. Every employer has a little bit different plan. There's 11 plans to choose from. Some have COLA, some don't. Some employers have Social Security like you do and some don't. So it matters, right? Folks who move to another Maine PERS covered position have to keep their money with us. If they terminate all Maine PERS covered employment, your employee can get a refund of all the money they've paid in plus interest. But while they're participating in the plan, they cannot borrow from it ever, not for any reason. There's no hardship provisions for this type of retirement plan. But our Maine Star plans are 457 or 401A do have those hardship withdrawals, and they're a little more flexible for folks. So I did give you a handout in your packet about Social Security, about the windfall elimination provision and government pension offset. And those are the two federal laws that cause Social Security to reduce benefits for folks who receive a government pension based on a period where they didn't also contribute to Social Security. So I don't work for Social Security. You should never take the word of somebody else. So you can call Social Security directly. Just make sure that you tell them you'd be participating in both Social Security and Maine PERS so you get the right information. Now, under our defined benefit plan, initially it will be optional for your employees to, when they're hired or when you first join, to decide whether to participate in the plan or not. And that election is final. And that means that if they decide to participate, they're always going to participate whenever they're employed in a position at the town of Raymond that you cover with Maine PERS, even if they terminate and are rehired in the future. If they elect not to participate, same thing, they could never participate unless the town adopts a new provision that would allow them to have an annual open enrollment period. And that would only apply for an employee in the first 5 years of their employment. Once they're 5 years in, they don't have that another chance to come into the plan. And that's up to you. You can adopt the provision or not. If you do adopt it, you should know that employees that join in open enrollment and participate in our plan, their retirement contributions are not federally tax deferred like your employee contributions would be if they joined when they're first eligible. So you have a reporting difference there is the point I'm trying to make if you adopt that provision. And you just have to plan for that with your payroll provider. All right, that's it in a nutshell. Yes, any questions? Yes.
So you said that service prior to joining the plan can be credited towards the plan.
Yes, you can allow your employees to purchase credit for that.
So but they would have to purchase it.
Yes.
And that could be quite expensive, like someone like Don, who has a million years of service.
Right.
As a town manager prior to Raymond, it would be very expensive for him to purchase into the plan.
Right, so if you allow prior service, they can only buy credit for the employment with the town of Raymond.
Okay.
But yes, it usually is pretty expensive.
Okay.
Now the town could say they wanted to buy it for their employees as well, or the town can say they're gonna share in the cost of that purchase of service. But most PLDs say if the employees wanna buy it, it's at their expense and we don't want any part of that.
So someone who's getting close to retirement age, if you have a 5-year investing period, you probably wouldn't go in this direction.
That may be true, right? So you kind of have to look at your options. However, there is that stipulation. If you work right up until your normal retirement age or older, all you need is 1 year of service credit accrued right before you want to retire, and you're eligible for those benefits. So on this, you'll see there's 1 year, 2 year, 3 years, and that's why. That's for people that join when they're older and maybe don't get the 5 years. They get a benefit. It might may buy them a half a tank of gas, but it's really something that is up to them.
So you could also have a hybrid plan of the 401A or 457 and PERS.
Right. And, you could offer both plans.
And but you don't have to match under the 457.
Right.
And because you're going to be paying into the PERS, but if somebody wants to go into both, they can.
Right. Yep. I've had some towns, they'll pick up a 457 and they'll say, if you participate in the defined benefit plan, we're not going to pay into the 457 with you, but you can pay into it. And they may also say, well, if you don't choose to do the defined benefit plan, we will match up to a certain percent if you participate in the 457. So I've seen that kind of thing happen as well.
Thank you.
Anyone else?
I'll ask a question.
Yes.
I don't know if my microphone's working. They would probably tell me if it wasn't. If someone was in Maine PERS previously, terminated their membership with Maine PERS, can they rejoin?
Yes.
Okay.
Yep. And you can buy, if you took your money out, you can buy that back, right?
Yeah, right.
But it would cost you more, right? Because you have to make up for all the interest that was lost, right?
Right. It depends on how long you've been out. So you basically have to pay back the money you took out plus interest.
Right. Yeah.
Yes?
Teresa?
Hi. Hi. So one of the things I've heard you say in there is the only thing that would be, and I, you had a lot of plans, is special plan two.
Right. For general government employees.
So like right now, anybody that's in the town of Raymond would only be able to get that 25-year one?
If you wanted to go with a special plan for your general government employees, right? So your public safety folks, your dispatchers, your emergency medical, I don't know if you have dispatchers, but police officers and firefighters, they have other choices of special plans to participate in. But there's only one that can be offered to anybody, and that's special plan two.
That's everybody else in the town.
Right. Yes.
Yep. Hmm. Kind of limited then.
Yes. Okay. And I believe that has something to do with federal IRS regulations for qualified plans. So that's why there's only that choice for folks that are non-public safety.
So if I used an example, Nathan, I know you're there. I'm going to use you. Say Nathan, he's the public works guy. Been here umpteen years. Because he's not under that fire safety thing, he would have to go with a special plan too of being here 25 years.
Or you could adopt a regular plan, right? The regular plan A or B. We only talked about A because B really isn't worth it, but it's available. So yes, you can choose a regular plan A, and that's the one that has the 25 years or the normal retirement age of 60 or 65.
Okay, so
yeah.
Oh my God, this is confusing.
I know.
Sorry, I'm done on mute.
It is confusing in a half an hour or less, but. But there is a lot of information in your packet, and it may make great bedtime reading, but if you if you really go through the handbook, it will give you an idea of benefits, and then you'll look at the plan chart and you can kind of get an idea of what the choices of plans are for different types of employees, and then the rate sheet gives you the costs for those plans. So I don't think you're gonna get the gist of it all at once tonight, but.
So Deanna, what is the difference between the regular plan AC and the special plan 2C?
Yep.
They look very similar when you look at your
Yes, and the only difference between those two plans is the ability for somebody to retire with 25 years before 65 or 60.
And that would be the special.
Without a reduction, right?
And that would be.
And that's the only difference.
Yeah.
People who are under special plans who don't meet the service requirement of their plan automatically default to getting benefits under the regular plan. So the regular plan A is always the backup for anybody that's in a special plan.
Charisse, have you done a calculation on the difference that would cost the town?
I have done a calculation on the regular plan.
And?
And you want to know what the estimated additional cost would be?
Yes.
Because right now we're doing, well, we offer a 6% match, up to 6% match. The additional cost to the budget would be $59,000 if everyone participated.
Per year?
Right.
Currently.
Currently.
Until it goes up with the COLA and everything.
Correct. So that's at the 10.2% contribution rate. I did not do the special plan 2C. So that's 11.6 for the employer.
Which is even higher than the other plan.
Correct.
Yes.
So.
And I'll be honest, folks, some of the towns that have the special plan for their general government, the special plan too, are finding that it doesn't really work the way they thought. And it almost makes it so that people stay that they might wish would leave.
Just here.
Just so they get their 25 years. So, that's just a reality.
Yep.
Anybody else?
There's a guy behind you.
Yes.
She's got a question too.
Yes.
Yeah, but him first.
Okay.
So we talked about the Nathan White on the public works director that Teresa was talking about. I've been here 30 years. When you talked about buying in, is there a formula that's used to determine how much that is? Or is that just kind of a roll of the dice? Hey, you're going to be $100,000, you're going to be $200,000.
Yeah. It's not a roll of the dice, but those calculations have so many actuarial assumptions used in them that we actually send them out to our actuary to be calculated.
And can you use, we're in a 457 plan right now, and can you use that money in that plan to buy into that?
Yeah, you can roll money from that plan to purchase service with us, tax-free.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. I will be honest, it's usually not enough to buy it all, but it may be enough to buy a good amount.
So would we have open enrollment then if we start it, and then they wouldn't have to pay interest or anything like that?
If you allow the purchase of prior service, we're going to calculate the cost for everybody, and it's going to be totally up to them if they buy it. It's going to remain purchasable for them right up until they retire. Of course, it's going to cost them more if they wait. But they're going to be able to buy, if they have 30 years and they only want to buy 5, they can buy 5, they can buy 3, they can buy none. It's going to all be up to them.
Okay.
Please state your name.
Yes, I'm Taylor Winslow. I live at 27 Baxter Road. And I'll say first that if you think my question's silly, just toss it. I've been coming up to Raymond my entire life. I moved here in 2020 after 8 years in Central Florida. So with the COVID, that's the question that's coming up for me is like, I was noticing, I think you said, I forget exactly what the 2014 distinction was, but I think there was a distinction for like if people sign off before or after that. And it got me thinking, well, in 2014, we had no idea a year like 2020 was coming. So my hesitation and my concern would be from your end, God forbid another lockdown never happens. But in 2019, we wouldn't have thought we would have ever had something like that happen. So say the operations within the town were to shift significantly, feels like kind of a foolish question, but my honest hunch would be like, if everything changes for you again immediately, I'd want to be able to pull that out early. So if that doesn't change your 25 years, that doesn't, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I don't know if there's any adjustments if like unforeseen operational shifts occur.
Right. So the plan is funded. The investments we have span the globe, and our investment team spans the globe.
Yeah, you mentioned and, Vanguard. Yeah. Is that...
Vanguard is who we use for our mutual fund, for our 457 and 401A type of plans. But our defined benefit plan, we're invested in absolutely everything, basically. And our investment strategy is meant to be long-term and take into consideration that we're going to have these things happen. Now, some things are not foreseen, and actually COVID was not the worst of them. It was the recession in 2008. But when we're making up for that, we take a long-term strategy of we're going to make this up over time. So there's no shock to employers.
I just would hate to put myself in a position where I'm paying into a system that, like, you know, if things shift significantly in the future, it might not be available, but it's safe for you guys. It doesn't affect me. Okay.
It is very safe.
That was my question. Thank you.
It's a great question. Yes. Okay.
Okay. All right. Well,
super.
Thank you, Deanna. And I can always reach out to you.
Yes.
With
anytime if you have further questions or you want me to come back. You know. I did want to mention. Oh, yes.
No, I just want to say thank you.
Oh, you're welcome. If you do want to join the retirement system, it does require a vote by your legislative body, which is likely your town meeting. Because you have a select board, unless your town charter gives you the authority to enter an agreement with us. So just know that it would require a warrant article, likely.
All right. Did you make note of that, Sue?
Yes, I did know that.
Okay.
All right. Perfect.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
So I'm going to give Deanna a couple minutes to pack her belongings up and...
Absolutely. Nice to meet you all.
Thank you.
It's nice meeting another Deanna.
So, I know.
We don't
think. It was very nice meeting another Deanna.
So I'll leave these with you.
Yes, thank you. And safe travels.
Okay.
Okay.
Well, can we head to the restroom?
Mr. Chair, while we're waiting, would you mind letting me know what members are there? Because I can't see anyone. Or the... So I'll know who's participating.
And which chair are you talking to?
Actually, the first chair would be Chair Goslin, and then I'll...
Well, he stepped out of the room for a minute.
Oh, okay.
But as far as the selectmen,
mm-hmm.
It's myself, Rolf Olson, Teresa's on Zoom.
Sam would like to participate. He doesn't have the link, so he sent me a text.
I sent it to him this afternoon again. I can send it another time again.
Yeah, do that.
And Bob, you want to tell her who's here for your committee?
Here from my committee, we have Sean and Deanna.
Okay.
And on Zoom, you have Karen,
mm-hmm. Bob,
and Dennis.
Abigail.
And Abigail.
Oh, is she on there?
Yeah,
she's on there too.
She's the A.
I just couldn't see who was in the room. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, we're going to start with a department head review.
Do you want to start first? Do you have any comments?
It's really, I have some comments, but do you want me to do that? Do you want to take people who are in the room? What would you like to do?
I guess let's take the people in the room.
Okay. So you have some provider?
Agencies.
Agencies.
So we have, if I may, Peggy Jensen with the Raymond Waterways program is here in person, and she would probably like to speak to the group.
Abel Bates is here, is with the Hawthorne House, and David Allen with the Historical Society. And I don't know, anyone else?
I think that's it. Peggy, do you want to start?
So yes, I am Peggy Jensen, still. I live at 315 Meadow Road, and I'm speaking to represent Raymond Waterways Protective Association. We've requested, I think it's $7,000 to support our courtesy boat inspection program this coming summer. If you have any magic for finding staff, we'd appreciate that too. That's our biggest challenge, is finding staff. But as you know, we are in a huge transition this year. Our dive team were so successful removing the invasive variable milfoil from the waters where we've worked that we didn't have enough work left to run a crew this summer. So we've worked with the town. Kathy's witnessed what we did. We worked with the town, and we were having a, the town is going to be supervising, but we're going to be hiring a contractor to come in and work those areas. We have two very small, very stubborn patches. And then, of course, there are the inevitable few stray plants that come up from little bits of root or stem. So there's not a lot of work to do. It can't be ignored. So we're hoping in this transition time to continue to supervise with the town. We will continue to monitor Dingley Brook and the upper Jordan River, which currently, as of September, last September, were completely free of invasive variable milfoil. We will monitor that, and we will remove any that we find, but we don't expect to find very much. So we don't know really what's going to happen to our revenues this year with this big change. We don't know. Imagine making a budget with a big, huge question mark. But we do know that we want to beef up our courtesy boat inspection, because that's really the prevention program. It's a whole lot easier to keep the stuff out rather than let it in and get going. So we're hoping to increase that. We've also been working on supporting the individual lake groups. So we've created a library of equipment which we have on reserve for them to borrow. If, for example, a lake group needed to send their dissolved oxygen meter out for repair, they could lose several weeks of data collection. And it's no one piece of data that's important, it's the whole collection that's important, so we can see what the trends are. We've also set aside some money in our budget dedicated to each of those lake groups for them to use as they see fit for enhancing their water quality monitoring activities. They can use it for equipment, they can use it for training, they can use it for lab fees, whatever that goes to water quality monitoring. We have two lakes groups that have begun to sample. They're using some special equipment that we purchased. There's a special device that you can use to take a water sample at different depths. And they are doing that and having those samples analyzed for phosphorus. Phosphorus is that nasty element that feeds the universe. And it feeds those yicky green things that get in the water that we really don't like. So we're a little concerned. We're getting some worrisome numbers back from that testing, but we need, I mean, everybody involved knows that we need to do more of it so we get a bigger picture, but we are very concerned about the phosphorus.
So Peggy, on the other piece of it, do you want to speak a little bit to the grant that you helped us apply for? I mean, briefly.
I can try.
I understand that we have not heard as of yet on the funding of that.
No, but we haven't. We worked, I came to the select board sometime last winter and I talked about the change in our DASH program. And our original proposal was really quite simple and straightforward. But then the folks at DEP heard what we were doing and decided that we should consolidate our operation with a little separate operation in the Lower Jordan. And so what was really simple and straightforward kind of mushroomed into this big project. And what Charisse is saying is that DEP encouraged us to apply for a two-year grant. I believe they were first available last year. We did not go after it because, of course, we were anticipating that we wouldn't use a second year grant. But this will guarantee our funding for 2 years. And then they also, out of the blue, and I have not heard of this for any other place, they have created a five-year plan for this particular project. And it is very detailed. I didn't bring it with me, but it specifies who's going to do what, where, when, how, and who's going to report and gather the data, and it's extremely detailed, which sounds a little overwhelming, but it also is really good because it's a clear guide who does what. The fact that DEP jumped in, said, let's consolidate this, let's put it all together, encouraged us a two-year grant application, and gave us a five-year plan, says to me that they really, really, really want this to work. And they have been extremely supportive throughout this whole process. Is that what you meant, Charisse?
Yes, yes, thank you. And I don't know if Kathy, do you have something more to add to that?
Kathy was part of this process.
So with the grant, it's estimated it's gonna cost us about $16,000 a year total of what DEP will not pay. They will pay 80%, but the town will only pay 50% of that $16,000. So about $8,000 for the town. We have three groups, Indian Point Campground Group, Port Harbor, and then the Harbor Condominiums that will each pay a third of the 50%. And they've all agreed to that, which I think is very good, because down in front of Indian Point in Port Harbor is one of the highest milfoil levels.
Just for the record, it's not Port Harbor who's participating, it's the Panther Run Marina.
Panther Run, sorry, it is Panther
Port Run. Harbor has given us a huge amount of support over the years. But
so we're looking at $8,000 on the Town of Raymond expense for the grant each year.
So when you compare that to prior years, that's a reduction?
Yes.
Well, actually comes out even, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Because there was
Well, if you put these two pieces together, right. if right. you put these two
pieces together. Well, I'm talking about the, aside from what we're contributing.
Yeah. Peggy, how much?
Yes.
Last year when you got 15,000, how much of that went to the courtesy boat inspection?
You know, nitty gritty practical terms, I can't be honest with you about that. But we usually tried to apportion that roughly two thirds into the mitigation and one third into prevention. Yeah, I can't take it down to pennies. I don't remember, but that was roughly. Anything else?
I don't see any other questions.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Peggy.
Not specific into that, but it's a general question. In looking at the spreadsheet, I think it's just where you got the column that says 2023 actual. That really is 2023 year to date, correct?
As of December 31st.
Right. And so, I mean, it's important for somebody else looking at it from the outside. If they look at that and all of a sudden see those numbers, it's going to look like, whoa, you dropped way down. And they, you know,
right.
So.
Good point.
All right, next up.
So we have David Allen is here.
Excuse me. David Allen. I live on Mill Street, and I'm representing the Raymond Casco Historical Society. And we're here requesting $1,800, which is a similar request to what we'll be putting in for Casco to help us with our administration and some of the maintenance that we do yearly on the the museum and the program. Some of you may remember we had a big request last year to move the William Watkins blacksmith shop. That project is coming to completion. We hope to have the grand opening for it in June, and I'm the exterior is completely done. The building's moved and stable for the first time in a long time. And we've now completing the we've completed the hearth, we're completing the chimney, and we'll start replacing some of the equipment in the interior and rebuilding that. But that's really come along quite nicely, and should be up and running for the summer's tour season, and to start doing programming in August. Any questions that we can answer?
You've already had one blacksmith program there, right?
Yes, we did. We had the people from Curran Homestead brought down equipment and put a program in place in August for us. It was very well attended. It was actually oversubscribed. Again, considering that it was 94 that day, and to demonstrate the enthusiasm, we had single people show up. We had families show up. It was really, really, really well received, and I think it's a harbinger of this summer.
So as you go along, you're going to be offering programs in traditional skills and crafts, basically?
Yes, we've been so focused on actually the physical moving of the plant and getting it up and running that that will start this spring, putting in place what we're going to. We put out a poll for what people would like to see for programming in addition to just what we can use at the blacksmith shop. The results were quite positive. We had a lot of good feedback, and we've started to reach out to some other historical societies around and to the school system for some of their continuing ed to try to put programs together. But that's kind of the second phase. That's what we've got to move into now. We were completely consumed just getting the plant moved as fast as we could. Encourage anybody to stop by and see it. We're there once the snow leaves. We'll be up there working pretty much every day, and we're always willing to show people what we're doing and where we're at with it. It's going to be a nice facility.
Questions?
Okay,
thank you very much.
Abel, do you want to get up and say something on behalf of the... Okay. Okay.
I'm Abel Bates, 55 Stark Cove Road, and I'm here representing the Hawthorne Community Association, and wanted to thank you for your past support and hope it continues in the future. I think the letter, if you had a chance to see that, pretty much outlines what we've done. We started this project 2019, kind of got sidetracked with COVID, but we've managed to do quite a lot of work on the building, and we still have a ways to go. We are starting our second phase of fundraising, and we're hoping to raise an additional $75,000. We're probably a third of the way on that, and we have some events planned. Our first big event will be in a silent auction in June. Hope that you folks can show up. I'd love to have you come down here and take a look at it once the snow's gone. It's a little hard to get in now. But all of the money that we have raised so far has been predominantly from individual contributions. Our membership has gone up probably fourfold since we started the project. We've got a lot of new people that are involved with it. And, you know, we're hoping to raise enough money in this phase to continue replacing the siding on the building. We got two sides that we're planning on doing this year. We have roof work to do on the roof, the front steps, interior painting, and some fencing. I mean, those are the highlights of what we have to do. And that'll take all the $75,000 to complete. We have raised, in our first phase, we raised over $80,000, and we've spent every bit of that on the building. So any help we can get from the town in excess of what we asked for would be greatly appreciated. we haven't had success in grant writing. We've made half a dozen attempts at writing grants, all unsuccessful, which is a little discouraging. So if any of you know any grant writers that would be willing to volunteer and help us out in that, we would appreciate that as well. Anybody have any questions? I guess not. Great.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hey, Bob.
Yes.
We are working with Sam behind the scenes to try and get him into this meeting.
Okay.
He's just having problems logging on.
So I guess we'll continue along with the TIF. Would that make sense?
Sure.
So some significant items within the Tax Increment Financing District, or TIF. And this one is an initiative we've been thinking about for quite some time. Nathan's been working on it. And the good news is that it's significantly less expensive than it was a few years ago with the advance of technology. And that will be to change the 69 ornamental streetlights on Route 302 to LED technology, as we did our streetlight inventory. Other streetlights are a couple of years ago. So that's a $30,000 increase, but that's a fraction of what we thought it was going to cost when we first looked at it. So it enables us to keep the really nice ornamental lights, but convert them to the latest technology for energy efficiency. And on the streetlights, I mean, we did all of the streetlights, and I have gotten, I think, zero complaints, pretty much. So people either like them or don't notice the difference. And so they are working well and saving us a lot of money. So I guess in this business, we take ambivalence as success, so it's a smashing success. So the comprehensive plan, so we had $10,000 in the current budget, and so this year we're asking, or they're asking for $50,000 additional. And so the bid that was just received was $100,710. We're going to do some level of negotiation. That's ongoing. We're going to look at ways to reduce that cost by the committee taking on some level of work. I don't know yet how much that will be, but you know, we'll be working on that over the next, probably the next meeting for sure, and probably getting that resolved at that meeting, I think. And so it probably won't be a, you know, $100,710, but it also won't be 50. It'll be a, you know, relatively modest decrease. I would say order of magnitude, maybe 10,000. So you'll need to come back next year and fund that difference. But on the worst case basis, you'd be looking at an additional 40 next year if nothing happened. But I do think it will be reduced. And so the other big thing here in the tax increment finance budget is a one-time reduction for the technology fiber optic project. It hasn't gone away, it's just moved into the CIP budget. So that's $100,000 reduction there. So I think those are the main drivers, Charisse?
They are. Some things are up and other things are down. We also removed the, what was titled the undesignated TIF projects for $100,000 with a tax increment financing district. It really needs to be specific projects that that we are working on or improvements in the district. And I mean, we do have some striping of you know, maybe perhaps some of the road and the sidewalks and other little minor things. A lot of the items are pretty flat funded, and I did move some the utilities. We had a street light line that was funding I think it was $4,800, as I remember, and it was $4,800, and that is where we're charging the ornamental lights CMP, And it doesn't really make sense to, I mean, there's other utilities associated in the TIF district, and that would be some of the cable down there with Spectrum. And so I have merged those together into a utilities line. So that would represent the CMP light bills, which has doubled, more than doubled, in kilowatt hour costs, and as well as the cable for the public safety building. Trying to think of what else was in there. I think that's primarily it for changes to the TIF budget overall. But I don't know, Ralph, you have a question, and I think we also have Kurt that may want to add some comments in regards to the TIF. He's here by Zoom.
Yeah, Bob.
Good.
Yeah, couple of points. I'm not convinced we're ready to fully close the TIF budget yet, because we're still waiting on the report from Bernstein on what's other things are allowable in there. We've got a $133 reduction and $133,000 reduction in there. And why did we take 10,000 out of the roads, Nathan?
We did what?
It was we were funding paving at 60,000, and you had estimated that, you know, we could really just make do with 50, so it was a reduction of 10,000 in the TIF.
It was just for the sidewalk.
For the sidewalk.
Sidewalks,
yeah. That's nothing to do with our road system.
Okay, because you know my feelings on that.
You scared me there for a minute.
Well, when I see a reduction there, I see a reduction. If it's legitimate to have it in there and we can use it towards other areas on the roads, I would be in favor of keeping that extra in there and using that back on the roads.
Well, there was some questions on, and I didn't get the answer quick enough when they asked me for the numbers, whether Viola and Elizabeth Ave are part of the TIF. If that is that, then we can pour that money into that paving. But I picked the sidewalks, as they're getting to be 20 years old, and there's some areas that need to be taken care of, both with the paving and the grassy train wreck area between the 302 sidewalk.
Just we've all been down that road before, and that's why we had to take out the $10 million bond before. And so I'd rather spend a few dollars now and save a few dollars later.
Yeah, there's been a huge increase in asphalt this year.
So if I may speak to your comment, Rolf, in regards to the Bernstein Shore, I had initially built 17,000 in legal costs to do an amendment to our TIF plan. And I think the difficulty being is that coming up with some projects that are, I think we've only got 7 years remaining in the TIF district. I think it expires in 2030. And, you know, it's somewhat difficult because it's very restrictive. And some years we find that we're just not able to spend all that the recapture allows us to spend in some years, unless we come up with some projects, specific projects, or the amendment to the TIF plan. And I know Kurt, you know, may speak to this if Bob would allow.
Excuse me.
Go ahead. Is Kurt there?
Yeah.
Yeah, he's there. So.
There he is.
Good evening. Kurt Labella, assessor's agent. Along the lines of what Charisse was talking about, the district itself is pretty small. It's basically along the 302 corridor. And the allowable expenses within the district, we don't really have of a lot of projects to utilize this money on. We do have, as you can see by the budget, a lot of the expenditures are, what you call indirect expenses. They're paving and things like that. We've made allocations for the areas of the projects that fall within the district, but a lot of the things are kind of indirectly related to the district, planning and the GIS items. You know, if someone has some, you know, really good ideas as to some projects that would warrant an amendment, you know, it's pretty expensive to do these TIF amendments. I think, Charisse, what was the estimate? $20,000 or $25,000 in legal costs?
Well, back when we were inquiring, last fall? I think it was around seven. She had estimated 17,000 would be a good figure to plug in.
And Bernstein Shore is not going to come up with ideas for us.
Well, I thought that. I hate to interrupt there, but I thought that was the whole purpose of us giving them some money, was to come up with ideas. So maybe we didn't define what they were supposed to do properly. But I mean, it was my impression when we did that they were going to come back and say, here's what you're allowed to do, and here's some other ideas. So I'm not sure where that fell down.
My experience in dealing with attorneys on TIFs is generally you come up with the ideas and they tell you whether you could do them or not. But I've not seen too many conditions where they will act as your economic development director, you know, and come up with, they don't know what the town's
outlook is
for the future. So, you know,
I think we
they
were doing,
need us to come up with ideas and then they'll tell us whether they could sell it to DECD.
I think we were doing both things, Rolf. We were going to ask them, you know, for their expertise and ideas, but we also had a reach back from Shauna saying, you know, what is it that you're interested in doing? And we put out a solicitation for that. So it was kind of both things, I think, back then. And so, you know, perhaps we have dropped the ball and we need to go back and revisit that. And, you know, I don't know, have we exhausted all the ideas that and all the things we might do under the existing TIF without amending it, do you think? I mean, that's a question. I don't know if there's anything that we could possibly incorporate that we haven't.
Well, you know, I can't speak to what project might come along 2 to 3 years from now that you're not planning on right now. But, you know, looking at the indirect expenses, it looks like you're, you know, getting everything out of it that you can. You know, absent some, you know, substantial projects that could be added to the development program, I'd kind of be inclined to keep an eye on this reserve fund over the remaining 5 years. And, you know, if what we want to do is we want in year zero, you know, in year 30, we want to have expended all the funds in the TIF so that we don't get a risk of recapture or a clawback from the state. You know, so if it, I think that the reserve has about $300,000 in it right now.
Yes.
I would say that, you know, in this budget, $286,000, that's about, you know, that's pretty close to what we're going to pull in through the capture mechanism at commitment. But if we start to find that we're not gaining any ground on that $300,000 reserve, when we get into the last few years of the TIF, we may have to consider reducing our capture rate so that we only pull in, say, $150,000, and then we use $60,000 out of the reserve over the, you know, X amount of years so that we land close to zero on it. That would be my recommendation.
That makes sense.
Sam must be there.
Yeah. Question back there, Bob.
Any questions?
Yeah, we have a question back there.
Go ahead.
Or something.
Hi, Taylor Winslow again from 27 Baxter Road. My question is about the LED lights. Are you guys able to clarify where LED lights are already in place in Raymond and where they might? I know you mentioned off 302.
The 302 ornamental lights are still high pressure sodium. Everything else, all of the other roadside lights are all LEDs.
So throughout all of Raymond already?
Yeah.
May I speak on this topic? I'm a student of UCF's Cognitive Sciences and Applied Behavioral Analysis programs. the cognitive sciences program in particular, I put them together as an interdisciplinary degree. Nanotechnology is the first thing you'll see popped up if you go to their website. So it's not just a random opinion. I am pretty well versed in the science that goes into this technology. One thing that I think is probably going to be surprising coming from me is that I'm actually extremely hesitant with this technology. I don't know if you guys have seen studies conducted. A parallel would be how they've analyze the impact of Wi-Fi and Wi-Fi transponders on life. So they'll put like a Wi-Fi receiver next to a set of plants, and then there'll be a control group. And the ones that are exposed to the frequency do have cellular destruction. There is a very clear impact on life. So we've all in the last however many years decided we all want phones and internet everywhere, but the electromagnetic frequency, the actual impact of that radiation on our cells, is extremely important to consider. I think a lot of the scientists kind of hope we won't really care or figure it out, just being honest. So these LED lights, I split my time, just being honest, kind of back and forth between Yarmouth and Raymond, which might put me in trouble. But the Yarmouth town does have the LED lights up and running, and it's really important to note that on top of each light is a data transponder, meaning a Wi-Fi receiver, meaning any technology that has any internet capability gets registered through the streetlights. So that might seem fine, but what that really enables is a ridiculous transfer of, I mean, there's a lot of electromagnetic frequency that is being emitted, and I don't know that we're all consciously opting into that. That when we want enhanced lights on the street, do we want enhanced radiation? Do we want Wi-Fi emitted? Do we want data collected? So these Wi-Fi transponders that have the capacity to collect data can pull locations off of everybody, so they know who's who and who's where, which I guess it kind of depends where you're at, if that's a good or a bad thing. But just to speak very intimately and personally from my position, I mentioned that I moved here in 2020. I was dealing with some health issues in the city that ended up being related to the electromagnetic frequency. I was in Orlando for 8 years. Those issues kind of just went away when I moved up here and I started paying closer attention. I genuinely thought there were no LED lights out in Raymond. And that's what I was kind of telling myself, like, oh yeah, it's just so much better out here, just closer to nature. And it's hard to say exactly what it is, but Raymond is definitely a much more natural community than most. And I think it offers a lot more natural energy, which is really a beautiful thing. And I have to at least say something to try to hold on to it, because as much as the technology is wonderful, there are implications that unless you've really studied it, people don't know what might happen. And cellularly, there is a potential of cellular disruption. There's also a clear line between data collection that people are not consciously opting into. So two things to consider. And $30,000, right? Save that.
Well, as far as I know, I mean, I could be wrong, but I'd have to check with our technology director. I know that the lights are, you know, internet able, and they provide, you know, data to the town on, you know, their performance and whether they're operating, but I'm not sure we're collecting anybody's data.
Well, with that being said, is that what's mentioned? Because anytime they come up, people just say LED light. I'm glad you are aware of the capability within the technology, but I don't think that the average citizen of our town does. And it's not just whether the data is beneficial to the town. I think it has a lot to do with if we, as, you know, biological beings with cells in our bodies, are really prepared to withstand that level of electromagnetic frequency. If putting these at every, however often they end up on the road, there just haven't been enough long-term studies on the impact of this technology. And to be honest, the studies that do exist are very quickly quieted. And this is coming from a student of the program. There is research that exists that highlights the cellular disruption that occurs. It just doesn't get spoken about enough, in my opinion. And I'm a weird 28-year-old. I'd rather be camped out than on my cell phone. So I know that most people are like, no, why wouldn't you want Wi-Fi? Because what it does to your cells. So difficult things to be aware of, but I think in a town like Raymond, we have that opportunity. Thank you, guys.
I'm getting rid of my Wi-Fi.
Just unplug it when you're sleeping.
Don't call me.
I would like to just say one other thing about the LED lights, and that is that if you care about light pollution and, you know, illuminating the night skies, the LED lights are directed precisely downward and do what they're supposed to do, which is to light the area under the light and not the black skies. So that's a positive, I suppose.
But yeah. There's also a really interesting between the
Mr. Chair, Teresa has a question.
Go ahead, Teresa.
Hi. For Nathan with the paving, if the sidewalks are in a bad way and somebody trips and falls, who's liable?
The sidewalks fall under the same 24-hour defective highway statute that our roads do.
So you have to be out there in 24 hours to fix it?
Correct. If somebody calls in any defect on our roads or the sidewalks or any access area like that, we have 24 hours to fix it.
Okay. Nope. I say leave the 10,000 in then. I agree with Rolf.
Well, we're on sidewalks, I think. That's a good place. I have gotten, you know, another place where we've gotten no complaints, only, you know, compliments. I know you've gotten a few complaints about the sidewalks and during the construction time, but, you know, I really am interested in, as I know you are.
The Main Street sidewalks?
Main Street sidewalk, yeah. And so seeing the sidewalk continue along to public safety, maybe loop around back down 302, connect to the other sidewalk, I think that there's a lot of interest in that.
Yeah, that's something I'd probably say be a couple years down the road, but yeah, we've had a lot of positive input on the sidewalks, that new section on Main Street.
But Nathan, you're saying 50,000 covers repairing that sidewalk?
Minimal repairs on that sidewalk. When you get into
does the extra 10,000 make it better?
A dollar makes it better. I don't think so, because I don't think I've got that much to do this year. They're in really pretty good shape. It's fairly expensive to do that paving because it's considered all handwork. It's up around $170, $180 a ton, where road work is down around 90 in that area. And I'd say no, 50 is fine.
You can make it on 50.
Absolutely.
There you go, Teresa.
No, put it on the roads then, the extra 10,000. You know the prices are going to go up on that, Nathan. Nathan, sit down and shut up. God, I try to give you money and you sit up there and say no.
So, I don't know where you want to go now, but I mean, I had some just general comments that are contained within your materials about the budget, and then I suppose we could just go into it by department. Is that what you'd like to do?
Yep.
So anyhow, the budget that you have this evening is not the budget, obviously, that we would hope to present, but, and I'll get to this later, these are, if not unprecedented times, they're definitely not typical in, you know, the times we've experienced over a longer period of time. But anyway, so the gross budget increase right now is $455,392, or 7.3%. The net increase is $358,382, or 9.53%. Revenues are up $97,000, or 3.91%. Of course, as in prior years, what's not factored into the budget is any new taxable real estate valuation this year. And Kurt always goes on the conservative side, but he's estimating $8 million in new taxable property valuation. So at the current rate, that would generate about $120,000. There's also not any fund balance, or more commonly known as surplus, in the budget. So I would say all that and tell you that there's also a number of initiatives that are in here that are electives for you, and we'll get to those as we go down through. And then there are some things that are, you know, that a couple of department heads, I think Public Works, Recreation, want to speak to, that would be, you know, even additions possibly. But so if you want to go by department, we could go to administration, or I have a high level overview of what's driving the budget, but we probably could get to that as we go. All right. If you want to do it that way.
Sure.
Okay.
So.
So Bob, I will speak to the general government administration budget, because you've got the overview in your budget books. It's an increase of 5.83% or $31,000. I thought it would be important because we do have a couple of new budget finance committee members, so they understand what the salaries, what they are comprised of. It's town manager, myself, HR director / finance assistant, the town clerk, the tax collector, deputy town clerk, G administrator / deputy town clerk, and a part-time deputy town clerk. I did do a chart, and you will see that, you know, under general government, that administration does take up the highest percentage of general government. So that's salaries. It is, you'll see that there is a slight increase in the salaries of $11,000. That is to better reflect the shared administrative assistant with the assessing department. Last year's budget did not really reflect the correct percentage, so I'm making a slight adjustment there between assessing public works and the general government administration budget. Contract fees up almost $13,000. I obtained an estimate from our trio, Harris Local Government, who they are our accounting software. They are our cash receipting software, tax collection software. It's kind of all comprehensive. Probably the only module that we don't use is payroll processing. And payroll processing is, we outsource that with Bangor Payroll. And other items that are included under contract fees and services is the background checks that we do on new hires. And we have a postage meter contract and then the KMA consulting. If in fact we do use them, it is recommended that we look at our wage brackets at least every other year, if not every year, and then a comprehensive review like every 5 years. Travel and training, not a whole lot there. We are now paying the non-member rate for any municipal training, municipal association training, or any of the affiliate trainings. And because the cost of the mileage reimbursement is up, because we do pay based on the IRS standard mileage rate, I believe it's 62.5 cents per mile. And because a lot of these trainings are also done via Zoom, so we have the remote feature as well, so that is a cost savings if the employee doesn't need to travel. Dues and publications up slightly, $680, and what that is comprised of. Advertising, I felt that needed a little bit of a bump, because if I looked at the year to date 2023 as of December 31st, we're running really close, and I don't think the 5,000 is adequate, so I did bump that up, I think, to 7. Slight increase in supplies, slight increase in elections, because they're paid minimum wage, and that did go up to $13.80 effective January 1st of 2023, and because with doing secret ballot referendum, the town clerk does see an increase in the request for absentee ballots.
There's also, Cherie, an extra election in March of 2024, and that's why I asked for an increase.
An increase of 1,000. Yep.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So postage is up just because the cost of, you know, the U.S. Postal Service rates are up. And equipment lease, we have two new photocopiers that we have under contract through an equipment lease purchase agreement.
So if I'm reading that correctly, your average employee wage only went up 2.77%? Or was there a reduction in personnel and it shifted the cost somewhere else?
That adjustment is the $11,000 for the administrative assistance assessing to be.
So it will show up in the assessing account.
There will be some in the assessing.
So what's your average employee wage increase?
We haven't put any in.
So it's flat funded right now?
No, that would not be the case.
It's variable, and so we, I don't know if we've calculated an average. We can get that.
Well, it's in training.
Yeah, the next budget that would be comprised of is the compensation and training budget, and we the FY23 budgeted amount. I was not had no really clear indication of what inflation was going to do. We granted wages, you know, maybe from an average of, I don't know, 3%, potentially 6%, depending on the performance evaluations and those that are going above and beyond and some of the required trainings that they're supposed to do, or deduction for the trainings they did not do. But that budget, average, you know,
right,
so
but,
not everybody's going to get 4%.
Right, that's the important point.
Two, there might be people that get 3, but there's a lot of, you know, moving components and how that's determined. Does that answer your question, Joe?
For those that don't know, we don't have a, you know, defined COLA. What we have is a merit system, and I think it's worked very well. And so, you know, it's not, there's not a guarantee you're going to get a specific amount of money. I guess you could, you know, you could average across all the employees and come up with an average, but that may not even be what you know, I mean, that'd be factoring the high, the low, the middle, and you'd have a number that probably would look different than most people's adjustment.
And the other thing that would be factored into that is the union contract, those wages that were agreed upon in the union contract.
And what's interesting about that, there is even a merit, as you know, the selectmen know, there's a merit component in that, which is highly, highly unusual. And so that's, I think, a good thing.
Just to clarify again, I'm sorry, I had to get up. So the employee increases are not in here, and the union contract salary increases aren't in here.
So the union contract for FY24 was an increase of 4%, 2% being merit, up to 2%, I should clarify, and a 2% COLA. That is a kind of its own little method of calculation.
But that's the only place you're going to see a COLA.
That's the only place that we've built in the COLA based on the union contract. Does that answer your question, Teresa?
Yeah, so okay. No, so I'm just looking at then the salary lines on all of these then aren't accurate then.
Say that again, you're not accurate?
They're not, the salary totals then are not accurate.
The salaries that you're seeing in each department, those mm-hmm. represent a reallocation primarily of the administrative assistant in the assessing department. So the 2.77 increase in administration is from the assessing administrative assistant being allocated more to the administration budget. And
right.
So that's where those changes are coming from.
No, what I'm saying is for people to get their merit increases, they're not added on this.
Correct. Those are under the compensation and training.
Okay.
Which I will pull up here. So it's an increase of 41.82%. We went from, I think it was 52,000 up to 75,000 in the training and compensation lines.
And, you know, we didn't anticipate what happened with the employment market, which is significant. And we've had, you know, some level of turnover. We've had new employees and, you know, we're trying to attract and retain people who have the qualifications and abilities that we need to perform the job. And I think we've done relatively well on that. We're competing against all of our neighboring communities, which is sort of a vicious cycle, but it is what it is, and it's essentially become a seller's market when it comes to attracting employees. And so that those are all factors, and I think that the estimate that was in last year was probably a bit low.
It was.
So we had to make an adjustment there, and you know, we want to, it's a balancing act. You know, you want to be fiscally prudent and as conservative as you can be, but you also want to be able to have the people that you need to you know, effectively operate the town in the way that you expect it to be. And so it's a difficulty, particularly in the area of the public safety department, where people have portable skills and can move from town to town, and they do. And so we've had, you know, I think we've, in the end, I mean, it's been really tough for some positions, but we've ended up attracting, I think, people who are, you know, well-suited and qualified for the job. That all said, you know, the town has to remain competitive if we're going to continue to do that. And I think it's also an indication of fairness for the existing employees. That's the whole idea behind the KMA study, to see where we are on a wage basis. And to, you know, I've been trying to hit the midpoint, you know, for people who are performing well. That's my objective. You know, you don't get there in 1 year, but, you know, we try to be somewhere in the middle of the pack. We're not the high payers. We don't want to be the lowest payers. And it seems to be working. I mean, we have a lot of older employees that have been here, you know, a long time, but what's more difficult are the newer people who can, you know, and do occasionally jump a town or two over, or maybe even, you know, head to the big city and do a lot better in many respects financially. So that's a loss for the town, but that may be part of the function of being a small town. You're not going to be able to compete with those employers, but I think we have to compete with the ones that are in our labor market. That's what we try to do.
Any other questions on administration? Then we'll move on to assessing.
Hello.
Not too many line items here. I can kind of hit some of the ones that had larger changes. The first one is the salary line, which is the assessing admin line. Charisse, I'm kind of going to defer to you on that one. I think that the increase that we're seeing there is largely this reallocation. I'm guessing it's like out of public works and more allocated to assessing and administration. Is that correct?
Correct.
Yep. The assessing contract assessor's agent line is, I do have a little bit of an increase in there. I don't anticipate any rate increases in this fiscal year for my work, but this senior stabilization program turns out is very labor intensive and essentially is an unfunded mandate from the legislature onto the towns to implement this program, and it's going to require, you know, 4 extra days of service load to, you know, make sure that everything happens the way it's supposed to happen. We're going to have tax commitment this year. We've got to make sure that the stabilizations are applied correctly and that the taxpayers receive the correct information. We have software company Trios working on trying to make that happen, but I think it's going to need to be heavily scrutinized directly after we commit taxes. Sue Carr and I will need to look at all those very closely to make sure they're correct. And then we're going to have another round in the fall of either reapplications for the existing law the way it's written, or it's looking like we're going to have perhaps a replacement law in place, and whatever new applications and rollout is required as a result of that. My hope is that after this next round, we'll end up with a more of a permanent program that's similar to maybe the homestead exemption, and then, you know, those extra days can go away and we can just, we won't have to require people to file annually, and the program won't be as heavily convoluted as it is right now.
Kurt, how many people got approved?
I'm going to give you a ballpark of 350, something like that. I think it's about 15% of, I want to say we were right around 15% of our actual homestead residential properties applied and were approved for the senior stabilization program.
It's going to be a big number.
It's going to be a big number. And so, you know, I don't want to editorialize too much, but, you know, to my way of thinking, it needs to be means tested. And that's not how it is. So we're administering what we have. And not only is it additional work for Kurt, it's a significant additional work for his assistant, our assistant. It's, I don't know if it was that well thought out, but we're trying to, and we
it's
will implement
it. It's the legislature, it's never thought out.
Right, so we will implement it the way that it's written. And, you know, so I guess that's what we're doing. So the additional time for Kurt, I think it's pretty modest, what I've observed him doing. And then Melissa has been a great help, I think, to him.
Yeah, and I'll just add, the legislature is conducting hearings this month on several bills to either modify or repeal and replace this stabilization program. We'll have to see what comes out of it and where we end up.
I think I saw an estimate it may cost up to $400 million when fully implemented.
That wouldn't surprise me at all.
I could definitely see that. I think the fiscal note on it only captured the current state budget at the time, and they didn't consider the snowball effect over time, which you're talking to every town in the state of Maine year upon year.
Right.
That's going to grow very fast. And the thing with the legislature is they, you know, once they've doled something out, pulling it back is like political suicide. So they've got to find something that the state can afford, but also doesn't, you know, make them look too bad.
Yep. And Maine is an aging state. So if you think Social Security is a problem, this is going to be a problem for Maine, I think.
Yeah. Yeah. Software, we do have increases on the both the vision, basically those are increases on the vision side. The camera software maintenance fees and the web hosting fees have gone up this year. I think that's pretty much all of what that increase is. A slight increase on supply line, and tax billing is a relatively new line in my department. That's traditionally been come out of Sue Look and Sue Carr's budget, so I kind of defer to them on the estimate there. I'm assuming maybe it's just mailing costs, tax bill mailing costs. Does that sound right, Sue?
Yeah, if I may, Kurt, it's, you know, looking at what we budgeted for FY23 was $5,000. We may go over that slightly, and it's because of because we are doing our tax billing in-house now. We have a folding machine, you have the cost of the envelopes, and then you have the personnel cost too, but that's, you know, they'll be doing something, whether it's mailing out the tax bills or something else. And then the increase in postage. So I just felt that, you know, we're using a little more there. It's a $600 increase over last year. Pretty minimal.
Yeah, sounds reasonable to me. And the only other item that I have that's not in that line is in the capital improvement line. We do have $100,000 for the revaluation reserve fund. I believe that $100,000 for the FY24 budget will result in a $300,000 reserve fund on the reval. So I think I'll be speaking with the Board of Selectmen Assessors. I think we can go out to bid anytime now. Any residual, if there's any cost above and beyond the 300, we've got 1 or 2 years
to pick that up once we get solid bids in and have an actual cost. That's all I have.
Any other questions? Thank you, Kurt.
Thank you.
Code enforcement.
Good evening. So I'll go through these. I don't have a whole lot of changes, so this one should be pretty quick too. Starting at the top, the salary line, that's staying the same. No changes proposed to that one. Contract fees and services also staying the same. That's money that's used to update our ordinances. Primarily, there's some other little things in there, but we are switching everything over to a e-code system. We started that last year. And so this year, we would be bringing in the subdivision ordinance and street ordinance, which are both severely outdated, into this new online system. And then there's also the cost to update the ordinances. Now we send out that stuff and it's done by this company, and it's done very quick, which is nice. So that's staying the same. Software general, that's coming down. We had a two fiscal year software transition from an outdated program that was being used when I started to the cloud-based system we're using now. So we're coming down a couple thousand dollars there now that we're done that, and we're just dealing with our service fee moving forward. That also includes our online scheduling program. Travel and training staying the same. Advertisement, that's coming up just a little bit, but that's based on really this last year, any advertisements we had to post. I believe that includes job posts as well. I think that's probably a little bit higher this year because we had a job opening that we had to post. But that's for public hearings, for planning board ordinance amendments, public hearings and stuff like that. So supplies is staying the same. Gas and diesel's coming up. 250, that's just based on a full year now of two code vehicles. So now we have a more accurate number on what the usage is. So we just got to come up a little bit on that. Same thing with postage. Last year was our first year capturing that separately in its own line item. So we had to come up quite a bit on that just to make sure we're covering what we've been spending on that. And the last one is the phone. We added a new laptop this year for field work, which has a broadband card in it. So that's why we're coming up slightly on that. Do you want me to talk about revenue at all or no?
Yep, you can.
So right now, as far as revenue goes, we're at, this was as of December 31st, I believe we're at 82,000 and change, which puts us on pace to bring in approximately 164,000, which is about 54,000 over what we had budgeted for the revenue. So we're doing good for this year. So we're going to bump that number up to 125 from last year's 110,000. We're going to stay pretty busy still. I mean, there's enough going on. It has been slower the last couple of months, but not drastically slower. So I think we'll still stay close to where we were. It probably won't be as good as this past year, but I think we'll still be pretty busy this summer. So overall, that would put us in pretty good shape. I mean, we're coming down with expenses by around 1,000 and then bringing up that revenue. So we're in pretty good shape.
Any questions for Alex?
I was just going to think, so they're just looking at merit increases, so it's just flat, so not the cost of living or anything, it's just going to be the flat wages.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, their budget does not reflect any increase, so any increases for that department are reflected in the merit compensation budget.
Perfect.
And that's townwide.
Townwide.
Yeah. Except for the public safety.
Right.
Because we know what that's going to be.
You know what that's going to be.
Perfect. Thank you.
But again, that's built
it comes, into the... You're right, it comes from there, but we know what it's going to be.
Yeah. Perfect. Good question.
General assistance?
Sure.
Okay, so general assistance.
Thanks, Alex.
This year, we've expended, year-to-date, $18,848. So the budget, we're proposing to increase it from 10 to 15 in hopes that, you know, that number is going to come down. You know, it's as I say, it's been an unprecedented time in a lot of ways. There's been a lot of strain put on families with the cost of living. And we have tried to utilize every mechanism that we possibly can. And for people watching, there is county money available that people can, I guess, probably see Kathy. Would that be?
Yep, they can contact me.
Contact Kathy to make application. And so we have some funds that are available to help. We also have Raymond Community Assistance Funds for people who are in dire need for basic necessities. So get in touch with us about that. But so we have seen a run-up in the in general assistance. That said, when you look at general assistance over, you know, my time here, I can tell you that although it isn't what it used to be, it's still a minuscule number compared to most surrounding towns. And so I think that probably says something about the demographics of the town. It also says something about, you know, I think a lot of people are reluctant to ask for help when they need help, and they should ask for help because we have the resources to help them. So once again, if you are in need, if you're struggling, come to us. We'll try to find a way to help you, if not through the town, then through some other avenues that we have. So anyway, on general assistance, that's where we're at. So we're asking for that increase, but it's important to remember that we get 70% reimbursement from the state. And I guess there is an LD under consideration right now, 258, where they're talking about making that 90%. So that's where that is.
For any of those people that like to follow what they do.
Yeah, that'd be Joe.
Any questions on general assistance?
Is most of the GA money going to rent and utilities?
Yes.
Yeah, I would say, yeah, rent and some food vouchers and utilities, heating costs.
On the food piece, I'd like to call out Kathy Goslin's work with the Raymond Food Pantry in getting some successful grants to help them. And so the county's also contacted me again about, you know, they have some more ARPA money I think they're going to throw to the pantries. So they were asking about what the principal pantries by town. So I responded to that survey. And so I was happy to see them put some of their money there and to help, you know, people who are in need. And that's been, you know, pretty consistent with, you know, how the county has handled a good part of their funds. So.
And I'd also like to thank the citizens that have very generously donated to the community assistance program, and to there is have been some, one gentleman in particular, who has donated many Hannaford gift cards that even folks that haven't necessarily been qualified for general assistance but still were in need, we were able to help them out. And the generosity of our citizens has helped just tremendously, and I really appreciate their giving and their willingness to step up.
That's a great point, Sue. And following on that, you know, the Community Assistance Fund is not regulated by the law with respect to general assistance. Mm-hmm. And you know, we have a standardized ordinance that, you know, probably people are aware of. And but if you're in need and struggling, and you know we have ways to help you. And so I would just reiterate what she said. The folks who have donated and put us on the annual giving plan, it's really been surprising and gratifying and continuous. And so please get in touch with us if you need help.
Anything else on general assistance? Town insurances.
Okay. Apologize. Still trying to navigate through this software a little bit. So probably the big driver of this is because workers' comp, you know, as you increase staffing levels, our what they call our mod rate is, you know, it's over 1%. So that means we're paying a premium for our workers' comp based on our claim history for workers' comp claims. It was 1.45%. I don't know what it's going to be for the renewal. I have yet to log in to the NCCI website to see what our ratio is going to be. The other driving factor is our liability and vehicle insurance. I reached out to our agent, and because our buildings are primarily based on replacement costs, the cost of building materials, he had suggested that we factor in about a 15% increase for the property section of the commercial insurance package. Other than that, I've kind of given you the detailed rundown of the commercial package. And again, it's some slight, you know, you look at the percentage increases, but they really don't amount to a whole lot in dollars and cents. We are a, when you look at the unemployment, we are what they call a direct claim reimbursement. So what that means is if someone files an unemployment claim, then we do pay that, but we do not pay into the workers, I mean, to the unemployment pool, which would be a small percentage of our total payroll. So being a direct reimbursement employer, I think we save in that area. That's all I really have for town insurances.
Are we still using that agency out of Farmington?
Yes.
Guys. Yeah.
They have an office in Skowhegan. I think they used to have an office in Livermore Falls.
The main office, though, is Farmington.
It's Farmington.
Yeah.
Bob? Yes.
So, employee benefits?
Bob's got a question.
Nope.
Bob Jones.
Bob Jones, go ahead.
Sorry. On the workers' comp, there's been a 64% increase from 22 actual to the budget for 24. I'm wondering if the town has implemented any type of safety program, maybe and is a program that involves incentives so that the employees are more careful.
I have my assistant to my left that's shaking her head yes for safety.
The fire department, Bob, did make everybody do a driver training class, an extra class that they had to do. That doesn't help necessarily with work injuries, but we've just started some of our mandatory trainings. A lot of folks just had to do the virtual
visual display terminal training for those that work on a computer for 4 hours a day.
The answer in general is that we do have ongoing training, and we try to we are compliant with what's legally required, and I think that your points are well taken, and with Kathy now in our HR position, we're going to be enhancing our efforts in that area. Although I would say that, you know, you can always do better, you can always do more, and we will do more and beyond the basics.
But isn't this increase mostly due to more employees and higher wages?
A part of it is due to
And your mod rate probably went up,
correct,
too.
Yes.
So
there's other factors.
Yeah, it's probably not a training issue as much as it is higher wages and
additional staff,
more people.
Right. And the mod.
Right.
Claim
but I think training is an important point, though, too. We are actually actively looking at that and saying, what can we do better?
Mm-hmm. Does that answer your question, Bob?
Yeah. Yes, it does.
Okay.
Thanks.
Thank you, Bob.
Okay. So, employee benefits that we're at?
Yes.
Well, the big issue there is main purse for public safety, $99,000, 12.8% of salaries. I don't know if Sharice has anything she wants to add to that, but.
I do have my overview on how I arrived at, you know, the numbers. I think it helps me to remember how I arrived at them is by having a supporting worksheet, so to speak. I did build in, like, and it's also important for people to understand, you know, our health insurance program, the employees get covered, the premium is paid 100% by the town of Raymond. And the town of Raymond also pays 85% of any additional coverage. That was not in my outline, and I apologize. I probably should have added that, especially for the two new Budget Finance Committee members. There may be, well, I know there will be, for the public safety union contract, if those employees, if it does get approved and move forward, that we move forward with Maine PERS, is that we have built in an additional percentage for them to contribute to their health insurance and dental insurance. I think I built in a 10% increase for health insurance. We do have, you know, we had did change plans January 1st of 2023, which saved money in the overall premiums. But in turn, because the premiums were lower, there are higher deductibles associated with those plans. And so to compromise that piece, we did increase the health reimbursement account to mitigate those increases in the deductibles to the employees. So there's kind of a balancing piece there. And the other driving is the Maine PERS, primarily for the public safety employees.
And if you go with all employees, it's another $59,000 on top of that.
Correct.
If everybody participated.
Right.
Which I don't think they will, but of course you have to look at it as when people are replaced.
And I did not build that $59,000 into the budget.
Right.
So
right.
It would be an additional cost.
The state program on health insurance goes away in July.
April 30th, I believe, the COVID relief.
They extended it to July.
Oh, did they?
Yeah, it's okay. The end of July. So,
I wasn't aware
so your employees should be aware that, well, that benefit of, what is it, $40 a month or something?
$50 a month for an individual
right.
plan.
So they're gonna be paying that beginning August.
Right. Thank you, Joe. I wasn't aware. I can't be aware of everything.
Neither can I.
I just keep.
Well, you come pretty close, though, sometimes.
Thank you, Don.
No, I was talking about Joe.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, both of you. Both of you. Both of you. You're both pretty sharp.
Any questions on employee benefits? Let's go to debt service.
Got a couple of bonds, the road reconstruction bond, this the sand salt building, $600K, and then the $250 for replacement of engine two. They were all 10-year bonds originally. And where
those
are we?
Those will mature in FY25. So
25,
this
okay.
budget that's being proposed and then next year's budget. Even though they were borrowed in 2013 based on when the first payment came due and when it was actually when the bond, the note was actually signed, depended on, you know, that based the first payment. So even though you think a 2013 bond would mature in 2023, that's not the case. So we get this year, FY24 and FY25, before those will mature. We also have the lease purchase for the rescue pumper built into this. It's not really a lease purchase. It's more of a government obligation borrowing for 10 years with, I think it was Androscoggin Bank that was approved at the last town meeting.
That's the 17,000?
Yes, well, 17 plus 41. Total of 58.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. I broke it out between principal
yeah.
and interest.
I see it.
Yeah.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Any questions on debt service?
So not a lot of debt?
No.
Not yet.
Well, okay.
Is there something we should know about?
Yeah, you probably will. It may not happen tonight, but yeah, probably next week's meeting, you might hear about some.
Proposed debt.
Proposal.
I mentioned that at the top, yeah. Okay. Just optional things.
All righty.
No other questions on debt service?
And technology is going to move to the next meeting.
Correct.
Kevin's unavailable tonight.
Let's go to public safety, animal control.
Do you guys have a hard copy?
They do, in their books. Do you need one to refer to?
Yeah, each town's is different.
So this is what was developed by the three town managers.
Mm-hmm. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Perfect. Now I don't have to go back and forth. I appreciate that.
Yeah.
Okay, so animal control. We are looking at an increase of about $3,000, approximately.
That $3,000 per town or $3,000 total?
Per town, sir.
And a big driver in that is the effort to try to get a more competitive salary for Jessica, correct, based on the KMA salary survey that the town of Casco did, and we had an update of ours and had that position added, I believe. Mm-hmm. But so that's the big driver, I think, in this budget.
Yes. Yeah, we aren't really moving much on anything else. Oh, yours is really different.
So we're talking about $18.21 an hour to $22 an hour.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
And that's split three ways?
Split the overall salary three ways, and you know, based, and this is based on, the wage is based on a survey of our labor market towns, but yeah, split three ways on the overall budget, including wages.
So the overtime will go up, the wages will go up $7,883. This is all split three ways, so you know. The overtime is up $2,000. So for pay, that would be a total of about $9,800.
Why don't you talk about your assistant? That's something that's a little bit, hopefully, going to be
yes, we were able to hire an assistant to work 20 weeks a year. So we can use her during the busiest times, spring, summer, fall, which would be great. So she's still completing all of her training, but so far, so good.
Do you get time and a half for overtime?
Yes. Yep. I don't know if you want me to go through everything because there's really not a lot of changes. I mean, we're up $1,000 for health insurance, $670 for FICA Medicaid retirement. So benefits insurance, $1,800. Everything else we're down on besides new equipment. Oh wait, I'm sorry, that's uniforms. We're going back up on uniforms. Equipment is down that much. We're up $1,000 on equipment repair and maintenance. That's pretty much it.
On the vehicle maintenance,
yeah,
how did you guys come up with that total? Because does Raymond maintain that?
Yes.
Okay. So is it based off of what was last year, or did you work with Nathan on that one? How did that come up?
No, I'm not sure. That's something with Don and Nathan.
I think what happens on that one, Teresa, is we looked at our expenditures, you know, annualized expenditures, and made an estimate. We did replace the car. We have a, hopefully, we use surplus vehicles. We had a surplus state police cruiser that came to us fully equipped as a canine car. So it was, you know, had been converted into basically a containment compartment with electro pneumatic doors and so forth. So that was what was in the original one. That car was pretty worn out. And so by the time it had been used by the state police, then Jessica, we replaced it with a used police cruiser of the same model line, I think about 4 years newer from the Biddeford Police Department that we bought through an auto broker and switched all the equipment into that car. But that will be the last time we can do that, because that way the next generation of cars that won't fit. So I think if anything, we should have less expenditures. Is Nathan still here?
No.
Okay. So basically, I don't know if we had huge repairs on the old one, but
no, we didn't. And a lot of this is actually going into our vehicle reserve.
And vehicle reserve, and then operations and maintenance, maintenance Correct. Of the vehicle. So we actually had really good luck with the other one, and I think so far this one's been okay.
Yeah,
right?
It's been great. Yes.
So the answer is no. Nathan didn't come up with the budget, I guess.
Okay. And the other question is, I am so sorry. What is the assessment?
Are you looking at the $34,291?
Yes.
That is our share of the of the animal control cost center. The budget is, the overall budget is, let's see.
$112,000.
So that's split three ways. That's the assessment.
What do you mean, like the animal control? I don't know. I'm sorry.
That's the cost of the whole budget.
Yeah.
All right. I've never seen the assessment before. That's why.
Yeah. The town of Casco invoices us, Teresa.
And we.
Yeah, no. I just didn't see it as listed out as assessment in any other of the budgets. That's why I wasn't sure.
Right.
What that was. Okay.
What's the health insurance cost? $30,000.
Yeah. Casco has a very high quality program
for one employee.
Yes.
Are you kidding me?
They have a program in Casco that you can't buy in the wild anymore. There's only, last I knew, just maybe under half dozen towns in Maine that have it. It's the top program. You can't buy it anymore. And that's what they have.
$30,000 for one employee.
Maine Municipal Association's what I would refer to as the Cadillac plan.
It's as good as what the school teachers get.
Yeah.
There's no business in the world that does that.
Yeah.
Well, not private sector business or municipalities generally, but it's very much competitive with what schools do, I guess.
Wow.
Believe it or not.
Wow.
Yep. But it is Casco's plan, and that I know that's been a discussion point in the past. Both John Holly and I, Jessica, can attest to this. We've raised that question before, Joe.
What's that?
We've raised that question before, both John Holly and I, and that's Casco's plan, and that's what they're doing.
That's insane. Wow.
Is there any other questions? Or?
Any other questions?
No, thank you.
We're good?
Yep.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks, Jess.
Thank you.
Fire department.
Sat too long, can't feel my legs anymore.
Last but not least.
Last but not least.
By any measure, right?
They could say we saved the best for last, but no.
Bruce, before you get started, it may pay for you to introduce the new assistant so that people in town can see who.
My first on my agenda, so it gives me great pleasure to introduce to you Deputy Chief Leo Connor, our new addition to the fire department, fire rescue.
Right.
Say a word if you
want. It's nice to meet you all.
Welcome.
I've been doing this a long time, and I'm glad to be here.
Speak at the mic.
Oh. Been in this career for a long time, and I enjoy the change and the challenge. Thank you.
Most recently with the town of Poland?
Yes, sir.
Yep. How long were you there?
19 years.
That's
so
a long time.
He's a seasoned employee.
Well, yeah, be conservative with his years. Those aren't his years in service. He's got many more of those. So.
34.
Well, we're happy to have you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Very happy. So, well, thank you all. And again, thank you for your continued support with our budget processes and everything. I know it's been a long evening, We have been creative in our attempts to help control our costs by using our association funds, grants, group buys on apparatus, which has helped save some money in our recent purchase of the rescue pumper. We're dealing with multiple things that affect our budget, and that includes call volume that's on the rise, our aging community, which increases our call volume and rescue incidents. And we're dealing with less staff to do that. In other words, our call, and everybody knows that, you know, we've heard it tonight. We aren't finding volunteers. No one's knocking on the doors anymore to come out and do this job and be woken up at 2 a.m. to go out and help resuscitate somebody. So we're dealing with all those things, and in this budget, you see some of the results of that. We've added the second phase of our additional staff that brings us to three people 24/7 to help facilitate that out the door in under 2 minutes and on scene in 8 minutes or under, and that's our ultimate goal. We have a variety, a large spread out town, so it's difficult to peg that and say we'll be there at 8 minutes at every home or under, but that is our average right now, and we're hoping to improve that. So that's the second phase of our 24/7 increase in staff, and that will give us, again, three people on 24/7. It will give us a total of 12 staff plus two administrative staff, deputy chief and myself. We run daytimes, and that helps boost our daytime staffing. We do have per diems on weekends, which also helps to boost that staffing. We've added, there's a variety of things, I'll get to those in a minute. We've added $75,000 in our CIP, which is our annual kind of rollover of funding for our vehicles, et cetera, that goes in annually. But there's a few things I need to touch on right now that aren't included in this budget, and unfortunately came in kind of too late for us to include them. One of them is a needed software update. I say that kind of, it's not really the right choice of words, but the company we use for software was bought out by another company, and they have come to us and said, we're going to go up on your costs. So we pay roughly $5,000 a year for the software, which is our reporting software, maintenance, payroll, well, tracks our times and schedules, etc. And they have informed me that it will go to $14,000 this year, and it takes effect January. So a group of chiefs, we are all together in Cumberland County, the ones that use this particular software have gotten together and said, we'll start looking elsewhere, and we're trying to work with this company, number one, to lower their costs for us. Number two, we're looking at the other companies out there to see if we can come up with a better product, something that works better for us, and there are products that are better, and control the cost. And we're also looking at this through the county's set of eyes, through the 911 center, and saying, you know, if they purchase the software and we all buy into it, will that help control our costs and let us do with it what we need to do with it? These are all options that are on the table. However, none of that money is included into this budget yet. So this is going to be something we're going to have to discuss, and I don't know what we'll do, but I don't know what the final cost is going to be. The other company could come in at $10,000 or $9,000. I'm not sure, but it's an increase to our budget that we don't have built in yet.
So to clarify, Bruce, you've got under contract fees and services, you've got $5,000 built into that line, and potentially it could be an additional $10,000, $11,000, $12,000.
Yeah, absolutely. So again, something we're kind of blindsided with. We were told that yes, they bought it out, that the emergency reporting segment of what is the program we use will stay intact. And it wasn't going away. And then it was, well, you know, we're going to modify things, but you got a while. You got a couple of years. And now it's, nope, it's going to change. It's going to change quickly. Another project that we're going to, that we're putting in for the future for grant funds, but will likely show up in CIP funds in the near future, not this year though, but just to kind of get it out there for you, is the need to upgrade and change our SCBAs again. These were purchased on a grant back 15 plus years ago. These are at this point headed towards extinction due to standard changes and safety changes in that very equipment. So that's something that we'll be looking at. And it's a big safety issue. As safety was brought up earlier, the particular one in particular is the masks on the packs we have now fail at a very low temperature, and the new masks are rated at a much higher temperature, thus protecting our people. Another one that's a huge safety feature or safety issue is we've all read about, we know about the PFAS, and you probably just saw a story on the news the other day. It's in all the gear that we wear, and it's in the part that is closest to us, and when we're sweating and hot in this gear, it doesn't wash out. So a new set of gear is being devised that is not constructed with the PFAS chemical, and that should be out within a year, which is also going to facilitate the need for us to upgrade all that. Right now, a set of gear is over $2,800, and this would require replacement of all of our turnout gear. Again, we'll pursue every grant that's out there, but we'll likely bring that in. And again, this is an extra thing for purchase through our capital. In closing, before I get to that piece of it, at the very bottom of the cover letter that we threw out there is that I'm recommending a staffing study be done, or at least bring it up for discussion. Funding of this is not included in the budget. However, we may be able to authorize that, I guess, to come out of our capital. If that's something that could happen, and if it's agreeable that we do that staffing study to see if we're headed in that right direction. I can predict, we can sit and plan and predict, but a professional staffing company could come in and look at this and tell us we're headed in the right direction or we're headed in the wrong direction. What might help forge those long-range 5-10 year down the road plans
for? What would the study should tell you?
So if we're staffed appropriately to handle what our call volume is, things like that, if we have the right people doing it, the right number of people doing it, and would help put that plan together and forge that for the future so that we know that, hey, we're at what we should be at right now, and maybe 5 years down the road, you need to, excuse me.
How much would that study cost?
Well, excuse me.
How much would it cost, 12K?
I think under 12, yeah. Yeah, I believe Falmouth had an extensive plan done, and they paid well over that.
At the end of the day,
yes,
they come in and they say, okay, you need to staff up an extra five people. We can't find the people now. So what's that study gonna do for you as far as if you don't have the people yeah, that you can fill it with, the study hasn't done you a darn bit of good.
With the exception of that's the folks that we're getting and we are able to hire is generally the firefighter EMTs. Paramedics are very precious commodities right now. And no one's able to hire them. There is stiff competition for those other positions, but so far we've been really lucky and been able to entice those folks and bring them in. One is the work environment, two is we are fairly competitive. We're not the tops by any means, but we're fairly competitive with our wages. And any changes we make in the benefits would also make us more competitive.
Correct me if I'm wrong, Bruce, yes, if I may. A little bit familiar with the fire department studies, and I think they also look at your infrastructure.
They will.
They look at your buildings, they'll look at your apparatus, they're looking at your staffing levels, your call volumes, and it's very comprehensive. It's not just staffing.
Yeah, and that's how they base the
recommendations,
final report. Absolutely.
Right.
So one of the things, and Deputy just pointed out to me, and I hadn't caught this one, so thank you very much, but the IAFF is possibly a venue to tap into some funds that may help with that study.
Well, what about the county study?
The county study?
I mean, before we spend $12,000 to do a study individually, should we see what happens with this county effort? Where are we on that? Maybe if it makes sense to work together on software, maybe it makes sense if we're looking as a sub-region to find ways to collaborate. And I guess we are really making progress now.
We really are.
So maybe we should look at that on a sub-region basis as well.
So you hit on a couple of important points, and that software issue is just one of the bigger ones that we came out and said, first of all, we all need to sit in our dress uniforms in a room as a group with the one or two people from the vendor and say, not cutting it, you need to sharpen your pencil. We have that kind of a power. I mean, there's 18 communities that are out of those 12 of us are using that.
Right, but what I'm saying on the county thing, you're talking about reallocating staffing and equipment and other things to better serve the sub-region working together.
Right. No, in touching on that as well, the study is in full swing, and the study is looking at how we can complement each other as departments, what we can do better together as departments. Can we, and I'm hoping this comes to fruition, that we can all decide a piece of fire hose at this brand is the fire hose we're going to use and all buy it together, rather than this town buying 300 feet, town buying 400 feet, and all of us paying $500 in shipping to get it to our towns. If we can get together, and we have hosted similar purchases, such as group foam purchases, and had a tractor trailer load of foam dropped off at our station, and everybody came to us to get it. Those are the kinds of things that county study is really looking at. How do we facilitate better group training? How do we facilitate better group purchasing and save money? That's what's going to come out of a lot of what's going to come out
now
of
we this. Bought in the last time around when Casco funded a study, and then interestingly Casco and Naples both, you know, didn't buy in. So what do you think the level of buy-in is on this one? I mean, we're looking at a little bit different group of towns and heading to the coast.
Yeah.
So more towns in terms of culture, maybe like us. How's this one looking?
It's looking a lot better in that my anecdotal true story is that I sat as president of Cumberland County Chiefs in a room one day and said, we need to buy number two pencils together, and I got laughed out of the room. That's just part of it. I said, let's buy churn up gear together and decide it's all the same, and buy instead of our 10 sets and your 10, let's buy 100 and get a discount. I think that's what we're going to see mostly out of this, because you've got the right people in place now to understand that my fiefdom is not just my fiefdom, and we need to do more together and collaborate on those issues. But we'll also see a strength in our response capabilities. But we've already facilitated that without the study, and you'll see more and more. Sunday, 3 days ago, not yesterday. There was a Standish, a Casco, a Wyndham, and our trucks on the scene of a gas leak in a residence. That's the norm now.
Yeah.
That's not the exception.
Do you have issues like, because I know we have so much mutual aid, interoperability issues. I remember the training, the federal training on that. But do you get on a scene and you're trying to fight a fire and the hoses and couplings don't match up on the trucks and things like that? Do we actually have that problem still?
Unfortunately, yes.
So that makes no sense.
There are towns that have different threads for their hose. I'm hoping that that's changing in this whole thing. It's limited now. I think Fry Island is one of the few that I am readily aware of. You have to go much further north to get into the others. And it depends on whether they like national standard or iron pipe thread on their hose. That's basically what it boiled down to in the past. Everybody is standardized more and more now, and it seems to be the wave of everything that is coming. I'd like to think, to a point, and Deputy's absolutely correct, that there's still some of that out there.
I don't think we can really fault Fry Island, though. Didn't they buy our old trucks?
Well, they bought our old trucks, but they bought their own hose. And
oh, so they changed
it? A lot of it came out of Massachusetts, knowing the background of the chiefs that run the department over there. They're all Mass firefighters, Cambridge deputy chiefs,
et cetera.
So, you know, a lot of that influence comes from there.
Raymond's unique because of where you sit. You have three different counties that you really border. Each county has different radio frequencies. Oxford County Communications right now is not really good. They're trying to get better. Androscoggin's got better, but there's two different counties or dispatch centers in Androscoggin County. So you got to deal with both. You have county, then LA 911. That's the issues that everybody's having. Nobody can get people. Nobody has the same gear. And now you're trying to fight a fire with everybody with different air packs, different gear they wear now. It just makes it a nightmare.
Yeah.
Nobody wants to go all in the same direction. They want to all be unique. But you can't be in this service because we all have to depend on each other.
How short are you on staff right now?
Very, but not as bad as our neighbors. And I'll qualify that. Wyndham,
so,
we go east,
so
they're
better.
So
what's that number?
They're better. So to give you exact numbers, we're often showing up with just four people at a fire call. It's very often that happens. Nighttime, we went out, we were working a cardiac arrest call the other night. I was the fourth person to show up at 1:30 in the morning. At the same time, Naples had a fire come in. They were calling for mutual aid. We couldn't provide it for them, and that was a fatal fire. So everybody's kind of in that same boat and kind of skirting the question, but I'm not. I'm trying to give you the general overview of it. Not enough people? Yeah.
We've been doing
How many open positions do you have right now?
Open positions? I have none in the full time. Mm-hmm. We have none in the full time. We've been fully staffed now for, I'm looking at Kathy because she might remember the date.
About 6 months.
About six. Yeah.
But so it's the difference in the call company.
Call company is
we've lost the rosters. I mean, right. I did the schedules for many, many years, and I was scheduling 20 call companies a month. Now we have like four.
yeah, members.
That's the difference on the call company that are taking regular shifts.
But that said, back to the point, I mean, I'm observing that we're going on a significant number of mutual aid calls and are an important part of the successful response on those. Some of our neighbors, and I know this ebbs and flows, it changes.
Yes.
I mean, Casco's come a long way up, for instance, and we have a very good partnership with Wyndham and Gray, I know that.
Absolutely.
But if not for our response on some of these things, and sometimes their response, certain departments to help us,
yes,
we'd be in big trouble. They'd be
Correct.
In big trouble.
Correct.
And we're not staffed where we should be in the call area, but yeah, but better than some of our neighbors. Is that what you're saying?
I think our mutual aid numbers, and you hit on that, and that really reflects where we're at, is we are calling more mutual aid than ever before. We're also responding to more mutual aid than ever before. So when that happens, we're putting out what we call a house call, and we're bringing back people or staff on overtime to try to backfill our station. So we have the coverage in town as well. I spent 12 hours in Naples this 4th of July with our whole crew at a major forest fire. We went to, Lee and I met, he was coming out of the building, I was getting ready to go in Norway. Who ever thought we'd ever go mutual aid to Norway?
Or have mutual aid from Westbrook to fight a fire up on the White Farmhouse Road.
And that's all what's norm now. Seriously, when I first started, if you called mutual aid, it was a sign of weakness. You couldn't handle the call. And I mean, but there were 14 people on my truck when I started. My truck, not my station. We had two stations. So that's the change we've seen. It's a big decline, steady over the years. And you know, I kind of get it. It's a lot of commitment. People just don't have time anymore to do it. That's a big piece of it. We compete for everybody's free minutes is what it's boiled down to help come in and do the training, become certified, maintain the certification. So it's a really complex issue. I'm hoping that we get some great ideas out of this regional study. I really do, but I think the biggest thing we're going to find out of it is that it'll be enough of the push to get us to do this huge group buy thing and maybe even warehousing and agreed to, hey, this is a set of gear, this is a piece of hose, this is a whatever, the axe, and it doesn't matter the brand. We decided that one's the one we're getting and we're buying 500 rather than five. So
my point is we should be looking at the overall staffing of the entire region as a part of that study, and I think they are.
It
that
is.
What the, that's
Absolutely.
The county study?
Yes. It's the
oh, yeah. It's a very, very comprehensive study.
With ARPA funding. And I sat on the committee that first vetted the questions, second vetted the vendor, and now has vetted their questions. And it's out there as a study being done, filled out. They will come around now to each town and in the next month or two and visit and go through everything that we have for records and equipment inventory, everything. And by October, we're expecting to have some kind of preliminary report back. So should be good. It'll be eye-opening, and I really do hope that it comes back with a lot of those very suggestions. Anyhow, so that's what we're looking at, and I still think that we should be looking at that study, and it would help recommend at least point us in the direction if we're going the right way, and it will give maybe someone else's opinion that what I'm doing is right. Or wrong. Maybe I need to be redirected.
And another point that they probably know about, but for the folks watching, because of the lack of staff, mm-hmm. you're actually not increasing the number of vehicles, you're consolidating vehicles.
Correct. In that
you're buying multi-purpose vehicles, is that right?
Yeah, we're actually getting rid of the two that we just purchased, the rescue pumper, but because of all the delays in equipment and materials, it's still about 22 months out. But the goal is to combine two vehicles that are older now and requiring a lot of maintenance into the one vehicle. It is a specialty vehicle designed to handle basically 80% of what the two separate vehicles did. We'll never get 100%. But, and so that it also takes into consideration the smaller numbers of people that are coming out to handle calls. So we had to consider that and help consolidate. So. All those things considered, we came up with what we toiled a lot over this budget, to be honest with you. It's low in some areas, the zeros, very few of them for increases, but those zeros to me also represent an unfortunate side of inflation has gone to what 8% and we're zeros. we're going to do our best to keep it in there. We know it's going to be tough on some of these things. We cut, for example, like we cut a little bit of money out of radios. It's not a lot, but we've been doing very well with replacement of our radio inventory. And in so, with the lack of staff and the newer radios, we're pretty well caught up with it. And for a year or two, we can probably go without buying a ton of them. However, there'll be maintenance on those and batteries to purchase. At the very top is the salary and the salary increase, and that reflects the union's contract, contractual raises, and the two new folks that we're looking to hire. Our contract fees and services went up a little bit of money. Obviously, we didn't know at that point what we were going to have for software issues. So that's not enough right out the gate, even though it went up 9% or $1,000. Our dispatch services annual contracts, 3%. That's just the way it's negotiated, and that's what it will be. It's a 3% rolling contract. Other increases, you know, $400 here, a decrease of $5, and down the line we go. It's not nothing very huge until we get to the gas and diesel. And part of that is that the prices went up. Our call volume's gone up, and our needs have gone up that way, so we're burning more fuel. We've had, a 28% increase in call volume in like 8 years. This year we went over 1,005. 60 to 75%, depending on the year, is EMS, and EMS requires us usually to transport, and we're headed to Portland. You know, and it's a 40-minute drive, even in an ambulance on a, you know, most days, unless it's clear traffic at 3 a.m. And those trucks do not get good mileage. So the part is that we had to go up, and bless you, yes. The other piece that went up, air pack maintenance, because again they're getting old and they're requiring a lot more maintenance now. And we went up on electrical costs and utilities, because those costs are being reflected in the Central Maine Power as one of the entities that's killing us, actually. And everything runs on electricity, so that's where we're at with that. And then the biggest increase here, hang on, was yeah, the utilities, and then fire department equipment. We went down a little bit in that, and we've got some folks that are really strong in their skills in the department, and our maintenance on the small equipment has dropped a little bit, because I've got a guy who could tear down a small engine, a pump, but rebuild it right on the bench in the station now. He's talented and he's doing good work, and so we got a lot of talented folks doing those kinds of things. I missed it in the very beginning, but we just had a grant that was awarded. It wasn't a huge one, but for forestry equipment. So we're developing those people and letting them run with a couple of the grant requests. We actually have three more that are in the works right now from three different people working on those grant requests. So hopefully they'll come up with some funding and we'll be able to get some of this equipment that we need. And we'll continue to ask our association to help fund some of the equipment we need. For example, that new truck that Don was mentioning, $20,000 is a light tower that's it's hydraulically operated light tower. It raises, turns, and it will illuminate a whole scene like it was a football field at night, and you can see everything, which is what we need for safety. Also, we'll be funding new electric hydraulic rescue tools for us, which will bring us up to the current standards, and we'll be able to cut the exotic metals and force doors and things like that on these accidents that we're going on. As a big challenge right now, the technology of the vehicle has far exceeded the equipment that we're running for rescue tools.
And I know you've been training, because took our bolt to train on electric cars.
Correct, we did. And that's becoming a huge concern. And if you follow the news regularly, you'll see New York had another one, battery-caused fire, five alarms. We're seeing these pop up everywhere, unfortunately. So this technology, the changes are causing us to have to change everything we do, our training, our methodology, and our equipment on a routine basis. The electric cars, you can't just put them out. It's a challenge. There's some equipment that's come out now that is being tested. I could buy a $30,000 piece of equipment that will help us put out a battery fire in a Tesla. I'm waiting for it to be proven and third-party tested and UL listed and everything else, or we're going to join in and we're discussing it as a chief's group of five towns. What if we bought one and centrally locate it and all help each other out? until we have an abundance of these fires, there's not the need to do one in every town. So we're looking at things very practically in that respect. Medical supplies have gone up, and we know that they're going to continue to go up. We've got several meds now that are in short supply. What was the last one we just got notified on?
Versed.
And ketamine.
That was it. It becomes a daily thing almost, and I keep forgetting all the things because it's a constant revolving door of stuff. So, but the cost of our medical supplies, one, they're going up because we're using way more of it because we're having more calls, and two, because of the demand, et cetera. And as you see it, you know, it's going up in price. So we still get a pretty good deal at Maine Medical Center, though, on our med replacements. It's not bad. And I think we've vetted that several times to prove that we're actually doing all right with it.
Maine Med just put on 5 ambulances of their own to transport patients out of their facility because the services that we're doing transports can't do them anymore. How many calls have we gotten to go transport people?
God, it's weekly home now.
Yep. We're a 911 service. We can't just send an ambulance out of town with one person in town or one crew in town.
Right.
So they're finding alternative ways. The transfer services are failing. You're going to see United fold here soon, unfortunately. It's just the way it's going.
How are we doing on billing?
I'm sorry. I wrote it down. I asked Lee if we had it, and he couldn't remember it either. So I'm hoping Kathy remembers it now.
We're doing well. We're up from last year.
Yeah, a little bit up.
So we went up in rates.
We went up in rates.
Last April, I think, we had with you guys.
Yeah.
It was back when Anthem was renegotiating their contract, I believe, and
we still have a few issues, like with Blue Cross Blue Shield, right. You know. But the state of Maine's really been working on increasing the amount that they get back from Medicare and Medicaid, which will be a big help. Because that's 65% of our billing is through Medicaid, Medicare, or the state aid. One of the things we're in this year, which I'm glad I'm no longer the deputy chief and somebody else is, there is a Medicaid study, and it's a very intensive study. It's a year-long study that you have to do. And if you do not complete the study, they take 10% of your money away. So
called blackmail.
Yeah.
What that includes, I've already filed the paperwork. So as of July 1st, we will start a year-long study. After the completion of that year-long study, I have 5 months to compile all the data. I have to work with medical reimbursement. I have to work with our own town because we have to include fuel cost, maintenance costs, wages, people sleeping at the station, food they buy at the station, lights,
it's everything.
Everything that you can imagine we have to include in this. The more we include, the better off every service is. Like Kathy said, 10%, there's only one service in the state of Maine that's not doing it. They have one transport a year, and it's a college. It's all kids. So it doesn't hurt them. They're not dealing with Medicare.
So Medicaid is doing this study for 5 years, and then after 5 years and another year to put it all together, they'll determine whether or not they should go up or down on their fees that they pay back, reimbursement fees.
And this is Medicaid?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And Medicare pays pretty well?
No.
They pay a lot.
But they pay.
They pay a lot, probably 75% less than, or 25% less than the private companies.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And our recovery rate, I don't have the exact percent, but I know when talking with our billing agent, we're right up there with everybody else, if not a little bit ahead of. So we're doing fairly well in that respect. So I wish we could improve it, but I think everything we're doing is working towards that for sure.
IVs, just a catheter, when I first was buying them was $1.75 a piece. Now we're paying $3 to $4 a piece. I mean, just the cost has gone up so much. And the technology is getting better.
Yes.
The state is putting requirements that we get some of this technology. Video laryngoscope is one of the big tickets right now to intubate somebody. A year and a half ago, I bought them for our service in Poland. Paid $4,000 for two. We just got a quote on them. It's $8,000 for two now. Same exact unit. It's crazy.
That would be one of the grants that we're working on.
Yes. By the way.
Any questions for the fire department? Seeing none, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Well, I got public comment on my agenda, but I don't see any public here.
You may have, I don't know if you have anybody online, doesn't look it, but.
Budget finance comment? Select board comment. Well, before we adjourn, we meet again next Tuesday at about 7 o'clock, following the select board meeting. So I'll be looking forward to either see you here or via Zoom. Thank you for coming tonight.
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
For next week's meeting, there are two separate distinct meetings. That means there's two links for Zoom. And there will be a short pause between the two meetings so that the videographers can end one meeting and begin the next one.
And we have two executive sessions, so probably doesn't make sense to come early.
Right. I'm telling people about 7 o'clock.
7 o'clock.
Right. Mm-hmm. Very good. Motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Still okay.